In this. Okay. Warm welcome to all of you in this meeting on local engagement fund projects that we're always a bit confused about, but local engagement in the city of The Hague. Maybe just to remember, we can be remembered that this week we started actually with the programs. Okay, I hear someone talking, but we started with the projects of LEF last year. We were just starting, we were just in a lockdown of Corona. And I think everyone was confused. We were in the lockdown, there was school teaching for children at home. We were just wondering, how do people get information? Even the press conferences of the Prime Minister were still only in Dutch and not translated in other languages or whatever. And Mika and me were discussing about, well, how do then other groups in the city of The Hague cope with this crisis? How do they do it? And actually, by talking about it, and also Wieke being the engagement journey leader of engagement, especially with different partners in the city of The Hague, and we thought it would be really a good idea, a nice idea, just to have some of these local engagement projects where we find out how are different groups in The Hague actually dealing with Corona. How are they living? How do they cope? How do they face the crisis? And it was especially a focus on more marginalized groups. So we had a call for proposals, and then these four projects came out actually of it, of our colleagues in collaboration, in working in collaboration, co-creation with other partners. And yeah, actually today we're going to hear kind of the finalizing comments and experiences. I'm very curious to hear it, to have discussions on it, and to reflect on it. And it might be good to know that we are now preparing a call, a second call for local engagement two, which actually also focusing on coping mechanisms with the crisis, and maybe now in the towards the post-corona period it could be, but then also with ISS researchers, but also with researchers from other Erasmus University faculties. So that's a collaboration actually between The Hague and Rotterdam in that sense. The deadline for that is the 1st of July. So please, if you have ideas to react and have a look at it, Wieke might send it around another time. It has been sent around already. But please have a look, because I think even if it's a small project, it's so interesting to learn about how people in our immediate surrounding in the city, how are they doing actually? So I leave it here, Wieke. I hope we all have a splendid time this afternoon, I'm sure, and very curious to hear. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Inge, for your welcome to this meeting. Robin, can you share the program of this afternoon with us? And then I talk you briefly through the program. Maybe first, I want to call upon everyone who's here. We have a very broad and diverse audience, people from universities, from research institutes, from the municipality, from various migrant organizations who are participating. So my question to you is, reflect for yourself why you're sitting here, why you subscribed, and why you are listening. What do you expect to hear? What do you expect to learn? What would you expect to contribute? Are you here just to get information? That's fine, but maybe you also want to network, to get to know other people. So you could share it in the chat, but you could also think about it for yourself and to make sure that you get the maximum out of it, of this afternoon meeting. You can see the program that we're having here. We just had the welcome. We have four very interesting projects with a lot of information we would like to share, and also a lot we would like to hear from you, and to exchange ideas and experience. So when we thought through the program, we said, okay, we're going to have four brief presentations, each 5 minutes of the four projects, and then we organize two breakout sessions where you can join the project leader of one of the four projects. and to really have a more in-depth discussion about the four projects. So we have 15 minutes for one breakout room and then 15 minutes for another breakout room. Then we have a very short break just to get yourself some water, I suppose. And then we have a plenary session where we discuss the feedback that this was received in the breakout rooms. And then we come to an end at 2 o'clock. So that is very briefly the program of today. Maybe I should say one more thing about the language. We're speaking English now, and we have been discussing whether we should also have sessions in Dutch or in other languages, and we decided not to do so. But I hope that the language will withhold you to contribute to the discussion. And if you feel uncertain or uncomfortable contributing in English, please feel free to do it in Dutch or any other language. And we are hardly any native speakers here in this meeting, and you will hear my Dutch accent, and my daughters are always making fun of my accent, and I think most of us have an accent, so that should not refrain you from contributing to our discussions. That was my brief presentation. I hope you enjoy this webinar. I would now like to hand over to Zemsem, who will give the first presentation.
Okay, Zemsem, good afternoon, everyone. Let me share my screen. Okay, thank you very much, Wika. And thank you, Inge, for the introductory note. Our research is carried out on exploring the experience of Ethiopian and Eritrean migrants during COVID-19 crisis here in The Hague. And we are 5 in the team. And to come to, there is a lot to the research, but I would just briefly present the main findings from the research. And the first has to do with language barrier, which relates to what Inge just mentioned in relation to the communication that was happening on briefings and policy, the press conference and the briefings that have to do with different sectors relating to education, relating to information on different measures. And this particular language barrier was reflected when parents were discussing children's experience with online education. And this experience on online education, there was an interplay coming from income and education status of parents. And the other finding relates to which relates to language barrier has to do with accessing services, accessing crucial services like healthcare, where people were expected to explain serious cases in Dutch or English, but this couldn't be done because of the limitation on language, and also accessing services like government support on unemployment benefit. Passing to the second finding, this relates to lockdown, staying home, interactions within household, and interactions between individuals of the community. And here our findings show that the psychological impacts of the lockdown were really worse on migrant communities like Ethiopians and Eritreans. And this has to do with either living in confined spaces like asylum centers or camps. And the other issue which characterizes this psychological stress has to do with not being able to meet fellow community members and restrictions to travel to home countries. And the other issue related to the social interactions has to do with the transfer of care economy from the paid to unpaid economy, which is home. And this was mainly borne by women, and this was adding the burden on women in taking care of the household. And there is also we also found that there was an increase in reports of intimate partner violence, especially for migrants from Eritrea. And coming to the economic effects of the pandemic, we have our findings show that there was a difference in the financial effect of the pandemic, and this has to do with differences in type of employment characterized by like whether people are in temporary contract or a permanent contract, and also the field of occupation people are engaged with. And this relates to the reduction in income for those that are engaged in driving taxis or freelancers and small businesses, while there was an increase in income for those engaged in food deliveries. And this has to do with ordering food home for due to the lockdown. And we have seen also no change in income for those that are in fixed term or permanent contracts. And the other important finding we have seen is solidarity that was displayed during the pandemic. And an important finding that I would like to mention here is a help desk which was formed by four migrant-led NGOs, and this has to do with providing legitimate information and responding to inquiries that have to do with language, that have to do with accessing information and accessing services. And this help desk played an important role in these areas of helping the vulnerable groups. The other form of solidarity was the support between individuals and within community groups. And this has to do with the culture of helping each other, which people carry on while living in foreign countries. And another important solidarity movement has to do with mobilizing resources to help the fight against the pandemic back in the countries of origin, specifically Ethiopia, where we have seen mobilization of resources to help the Ministry of Foreign, the call from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. These are the major findings, but if you'd like to hear more about the policy lessons that we drew from our findings and if you have questions, we welcome you to join our breakout rooms. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Samsam, for this presentation. And this is really a good call for people to join you in the breakout rooms, I think. So thank you. And now I would like to move straight forward to Helen, who will give a presentation.
Hey, Robin is sharing the screen. Hello, Robin. Okay, so just acknowledging here on the front page, all those who are actually contributors to this project, with special thanks to our mother project at the Open University called COV19. Okay, this slide can go, Robin. Yeah, so when we first started, before even LEF funding started, we started something called COV19 Chronicles. And these are two photos contributed early on, in fact, by ISS alumni. So they were talking about the effect of lockdown on them. So that's how we started. And then we can go to the next slide. Okay, this slide is a video which is on the COP19 Chronicles website.
Morning and share something special with husband. These moments are precious in our lives. After trying several years, finally, we were welcoming our second child in June 2020.
Okay, Robin, you can stop that one if you like, because the sound is quite poor quality. So I just wanted to say that that video was recorded by an undocumented woman who had her baby in June last year. And she describes, you know, both the tribulations and the joy of that. And in fact, how it turned her to spirituality. When I say spirituality, I mean all religions, in the hope that things would work out. So next slide, please. Okay, I'm going to simply read this poem, which was written in French by somebody who, his not his real name, is Dino, an Algerian undocumented migrant who has been in the Netherlands for about 25 years. These flowers withered years ago. In the years and years that have condemned us, when my time comes, I will answer the call. Bury me in my house, my front door key, a simple shovel. Although in their eyes we are but weeds, the wheel turns. Oh, sorry, Robin, you'll have to go back for a second. The wheel turns as I negotiate the bends. When we think it's all over, fate will hit us harder than before. Once God has blessed us, no one can harm us anymore. But well, yes, these flowers withered years ago.
Entrusted me the key of their houses, which means they have unquestionable trust in me. I, in return, have shown my loyalty to them by working hard to clean up their houses. I've been cleaning their houses for many, many years, since they hired me. For more than a month during the lockdown, I had not used many of the keys. However, the corona pandemic crisis proved that trust is not enough for a relationship.
Sorry, can you stop it there, Robin, for a minute? Robin, sorry, can you stop it for a minute? Thank you. Jack, who was just speaking on that video, is here. And I'd like to invite him if he has any comment on that video now, if he wishes to make it. He's not obliged, but Jack, you may if you wish to say something quickly. You're muted.
Okay, yeah. It was really a terrible experience. So expecting that our employers would assist us in times of crisis, but it proved to be that when the crisis occurs without getting any assistance from them, although they gave some nice words, but of course that's not enough. What we need, of course, is to how to survive. Thank you.
Thank you. And then we have a little music, because this project was a focus on creativity, so that includes the art. So perhaps you can play a little bit of this, Robin. Thank you.
And when I came to the church, when I went to buy the flowers, they were so beautiful. And it gave me hope. Every time I went and I did the flowers in the church, I saw something beautiful, something special. I took note of every, like the leaves, I would look really into it, how they would change. And the water that I put in the water vases, if say I go 2 days after, it has gone down. And to me, that was life. And the lilies, I buy them close, and in 2 days or 3 days time, they were open. So it was kind of responding to me, like, thank you. It was fulfilling, giving me hope that there is more. And in the church, it was wonderful.
Robin?
Yes, Alan, do we need to go back to this video?
Yeah, I just wanted to briefly explain that video that was part of, Vicky was talking as part of a Zoom meeting in which she said a lot more about the importance of faith for her and the role of the church in getting her through this. So I just wanted to mention that. Thank you. Then we can finish on the last, which is from Dalmar, who's also here.
When I came to...
Is this moving?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Robin. I think we've come to the last slide, if I'm not mistaken. And we also have Joy. If she wishes to say something, she's welcome. But if not, I can also say something about this. Joy? No. Okay, so this was the previous slide, Robin, was a... this was a, you can see this is Haag's West End Ziekenhuis. It's the hospital in The Hague. And during lockdown, there is no one around. But so you take a photo and you put it on social media so people see it. And this is a protest, two-person protest, socially distanced, asking for papers for all. And actually what's interesting now in Holland is that the request for general pardon, which means regularization of undocumented migrants, is in fact starting again. The last time was 2008. There are now moves to demand regularization again in the Netherlands. So this protest was part of a wider movement that is taking up momentum. If you're interested in more about how we collected these images, videos, music, etc., then you can join our group. Thanks so much. Thank you very much. These are the websites that you can look at.
Thank you, Helen. I think it was a very impressive series of videos and statements. And for anyone who wants to hear more about this, please join the session with Helen to get some more background information. So now I would like to move on to the third presentation, which is by Kees. And Kees started sharing his screen already. So Kees, please go ahead. You're on mute, Kees.
Yeah, if you start your screen, you can't unmute. Okay, thanks. Thanks, Wieke. Also, thanks, Helen and Sam. Very nice, inspiring inputs. I briefly will tell something about a project that was originally called ISS Engagement with Organizations in The Hague during COVID. And that gradually sort of went into a project about lessons learned from local as well as international solidarity. We did it with several MA students at ISS and with Olivia from the local engagement team of ISS. It was originally sort of a project related to a big conference that ISS was organizing last year in July, which was then postponed to this year, July. And in that conference, we wanted to invite organizations from all over The Hague, also in the theme of the conference, which was about solidarity, but also about peace and social justice. What we did was basically do storytelling workshops, but because of COVID, we had to do it online. That was still the time that we sort of were not used to doing all these things online. So we were surprised to see how fantastic storytelling can actually be in an online setting, even though you miss lots of the creativity and the energy in the room. The positive thing was that we could have people from all over the world in the same webinar. And that was sort of very exciting, especially in the beginning. So we had several webinars. I want to sort of draw out sort of lessons from two of them. You see pictures from Vietnam, from India, about people involved in international and local solidarity efforts. So the first seminar involves especially international development organizations in The Hague and their partner organizations or their networks. And what we asked them to do is to prepare short stories about their experiences of international solidarity. The points that we sort of learned from that was that, first of all, COVID had thrown a lot of processes many years back, education, health, economy. Zemzem mentioned already the issue of gender-based violence, domestic violence was big, and that required targeted training and dedication. The most vulnerable areas in relation to COVID, the COVID situation, were not cared for by the government. We had, for example, examples from Kenya with the disabled, but also Somalia, where we had examples that resilience was the best attitude in that crisis. So, but people were creative, and the conviction was to act now and not later, but also to learn and to take the lessons learned during the pandemic beyond the pandemic. So also that this period was seen as a rich period of innovation. In the second seminar, we invited local organizations, organizations operating in The Hague, working more on community solidarity. And there we had sort of more stories about what happened in smaller community where we learned that the most vulnerable are actually affected, and that it all happens next door. COVID was just coming very closely, but also the way of dealing with it became very immediate in the sense of that solidarity was possible. It was easier actually to realize than people thought. So lessons that were learned from that discussion is that actually solidarity is a matter of actually doing it. Even though there's a difference between the solidarity in the sense of mutuality and more the charitable sort of options, but it was also found that both approaches were important. Sort of a second important element out of it was that the whole co-creation of knowledge in this research project actually is possible to do online. But also that the webinar sort of worked as a source of generating hope. And sort of a third element that came out of the discussions is that the ISS community with all its networks worldwide, which we call the ISS diaspora, all the MA alumni and PhD alumni worldwide, is actually very active and was very active also during the COVID pandemic, supporting each other. So a final point is that we take all of these elements now to a big conference that we are organizing in July, the postponed conference, where we are again organizing around a few dozen visits to organizations in the Netherlands, or virtual, building on what we have done in this project as well, but also to strengthen relationships between the ISS academic community and the professional community of organizations in The Hague and the Netherlands. So I'm happy to sort of elaborate more in the smaller groups. Okay.
Thank you, Kees, for your presentation. And I think you highlighted once more what was also mentioned already by Zemzem and Helen, that it's not just the migrant community here in The Hague, but that they have their roots and their bonding with their home countries, and how that also is impacted by the COVID pandemic. So people who would like to discuss more on this, please go to the group of Kees. And now I would like to give the floor to Rosalba for the final presentation.
Hello, Rosalba. Hello everyone. Thank you, Vike. As one of the members of the collaborative research, we won't think what we won't do. Learning from stories of solidarity in times of COVID-19 in The Hague, I thank your attention and invite you all to watch our video by clicking on the link that I have already shared in the chat. So please, if you can join us and watch it individually, and we will come back to this plenary in a second. Well, I assume that most of you have finished the video. Yes? Okay. So on behalf of the members of the team, Learning from Stories of Solidarity, Aminata Cairo, Daniela Bicherat, Yoti Tribrikram, Stephen and Said Antoni, Umbrin Salim and Lisa Marlene Gronemeyer, I would like to invite you to join us in our breakout room where we will be sharing with you some more stories of solidarity. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosalba, for this sharing this this video in such a way. And I think this is really challenging for people to join you in your breakout session. And luckily, we have two breakout sessions. So people, there are so many interesting stories. We have two opportunities to join one of the breakout sessions. In a minute, you will be given the choice to join the group of your choice. The first one will be Zemzem. The second one will be Helen, the third will be Kees, and the fourth will be with Rosalba. I should mention to you that the breakout rooms will not be recorded, and the things posted in the chat environment will not be stored. So if you would like to keep information, please take a video or take a screen print of the chat, because we can't give that to you later on. And I think with Rosalba sharing this video in the chat, if you have interesting videos or websites to share, please do it in the plenary chat, because that will be stored. So Robin, could you now give everyone the choice for one of the breakout rooms? We have two sessions, each 15 minutes, and after the first session, you will come back to the plenary session and you can make your second choice. Robin, can you start? The breakout
rooms. All the rooms are open. People can choose to which one they want to go.
But we don't see them yet.
They're probably somewhere. I already see Semsem going, Adinda going, Helen. So probably if you do the close the participants window, there should be a window with more breakout sessions.
Robin, I are really all coming back.
Do you hear me still? So it's important to give the education for the people.
Okay, thank you, Haymanot.
Education, you mean?
I mean basic education. I mean information for listening about the vaccination. Just the right information. It's the lack of information, the type of the vaccination, the side effects, you know, all these informations, I mean.
Given the background they have, you mean?
Yes. I mean, they are organizations, they are busy also to give this basic information about the vaccination, but it needed also with the newcomers, not only for Ethiopian Eritrean, it was for many migrants, but still it is an attention needed, especially for the newcomers.
I think you're continuing a very interesting discussion you just had, but I'm sorry I have to break in now, because we haven't been part, all of us, in of that discussion. But it's nice to hear that there are so many comments. And I hope you enjoyed the breakout session and you had interesting insights. May I ask whether someone could share some of the insight, maybe one of the project leaders. Could one of you mention something, a new insight that you didn't think of, or a new perspective? Can I give the floor to one of the project leaders?
Hello.
Binyam, yes?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that that was a hot issue in our discussion was the responsibility of helping the migrants. So it was, it was shared with all of us that this supposed to be the responsibility of the municipality, but in terms of practice, there is no any engagement from the municipality, while other people are voluntarily show, you know, their readiness to help the marginalized people. So that's something we love. But the other way, which would be possible, is why we also simply wait them municipality to come to us. I mean, even those help desks, maybe they expose themselves to the municipality with, you know, the project they have and asking help. You know, we come all this way and we need now, you know, some support. And what could you offer? You know, so that's something we learned in the discussion, or we heard from the participants.
Thank you. So you have to reach out from all sides, in fact, that's the message. I just realized that I did not announce that we are going to skip the break. We just discussed that, but we're running out of time already, and we have only 15 minutes left. So I thought just skip the break and then we stop at 2 o'clock. And I see even one comment in the chat, the time was too short in the breakout room. So I understand that. And maybe there's another way of continuing the discussion and reach out to each other also here and to continue the discussion. Is there anyone else who would like to contribute anything? Whom can I give the floor?
Rosalba, yeah.
Yes, thank you, Vike. I think that one of the highlights from what we heard is the need of infrastructures for solidarity to flourish, and how there are some excellent examples coming around communities that are normally not included in research that deals with solidarity, as if people from different migratory backgrounds have not been actively engaged in acts of solidarity. And the second point is that perhaps the focus of our research is more on the how, not only on the what are we collecting and what those data is actually informing, but how we are collecting that data. I think that this is the two highlights that I want to emphasize.
Thank you, Rosalba. Is there anyone from the audience who would like to respond or to reflect? I asked at the beginning of this meeting, I asked you with what objectives are you coming to this meeting? Do I see a hand of Daniela? Is that correct?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to add to what Rosalba said, and perhaps in connection to the comments that are in the chat, that part of the infrastructures is not only about the material physical things that are out there, but about having the time to engage and to relate to the things that are happening there. Similarly, like in this room, right? So giving each other the time to tell the stories and not simply rush through them or just extract them and then tell them and plus them, sort of paste them in an article, but actually give each other, one another here in this room, but also in the way we do research outside, give one another time to engage together in actually supporting in each other in times of crisis.
Thank you. Anyone else who would like to comment?
Yes, I would like. My name is Haymanut. I was one of the respondents from this project. And what I would like to comment is, of course, there are Dutch funders or the municipality. Maybe they have their way of, during the COVID to help the migrants. But the point is, it is not accessible for migrants or their criteria. For example, funds acting of others. If you want to do that project, you have to really show photos for the people. You have to write reports. It's also very difficult, you know, to make that project because it is really, you have to do it one and one. Because of the COVID. So sometimes there is a fund, there is a project, but it does not fit with the group or the way it has to be really, reach out. That is the comment I want to give. Now also we have the second step, this vaccination, still we need also, but it has to be individual still. People, they have to get trust, still not safe to have in the master group to give the education. And the municipality has also here maybe a point. I don't see somebody from the municipality anyway, just I want to drop this.
Okay, thank you. I know that at least there's one person from the municipality who was there earlier, but I don't know whether she's still in and whether she can respond to this. If Fabienne is there and can respond, please take the floor. And if not, I think we can continue. I think in general, this whole pandemic, I mean, it is beyond whatever you can imagine what was happening. And I think it was one steep learning curve for everyone personally, but also organizations and municipalities on how are we dealing with this and what are we missing out on, and can we reach everyone? So I think that's really a steep learning curve. And well, I don't hope that we'll have another pandemic, but.
I would like to say something. Yeah? I'm from the GGD in Leiden, but I also work for the GGD Haaglanden. I think what is happening with people and problems that all this pandemic shows where our weaknesses are, where people are have difficulty in matching up with society, is the same for organizations and the way we have organized our policies. So what we see is, yes, there is no material in different languages. We do as governments very little to reach certain groups. And now with this pandemic, you can see what the problem is, how important this is. So I think we should not think as if this is something special and next year it will be back to normal. No, we have to learn what has gone wrong and do something about it. So I'm going to contact the person from the municipality. I really feel that something should be done. Not that we talk. I also agree with Daniela, who says we have to give each other time to engage and things, to listen to each other. But I also like things to, you know, to change. And this message should go to people whoever can do something about it. So if there is anything I can carry with me to bring the message further, then please share it with me.
Thank you, Adi. I think this was a clear message, and I know that Fabienne, who is from the municipality, was very interested in this research, and so I hope she can also take it further within the municipality to the relevant departments. But at the same time, like you said, we're all this really hit us all, and everyone has to organize themselves and I think make use of all these insights that we are now collecting through these kind of research projects. Is there anyone else who would like to comment or to contribute to this discussion?
Yeah, I think
Roy. Oh, I think first Roy and then Dalma.
Dalma can go first.
Jan was already holding the hand up for quite a while.
Oh, okay. Yes. So I then think Jan, Dalma, Roy, right?
Well, thanks for this opportunity. I've worked quite a bit with the City of Rotterdam, the City Council of Rotterdam, and community organizations in Rotterdam. And at the start of the pandemic, the City of Rotterdam really looked at it like a health issue, right, which needed to be addressed by health. And it's really only the slowly over time that it has been realized that it's to a large extent a social issue. And that issues like solidarity and loneliness, etc., matter a lot. And that is also something city council should look into. So I've really seen over time a change in city council, at least in Rotterdam, towards more social issues of resilience. And realizing that a link has to be made with all these solidarity initiatives, which to a large extent are invisible, definitely invisible to city councils. And now at least in Rotterdam there's a great realization that there are no linkages with them, right? That these are like two separate worlds and that we have to find more ways to make the invisible visible and to see how they can engage with the government without the government stifling any initiatives, right? Because the government may very easily take up a very negative controlling role instead of a more listening to the story role, which has been expressed today. But this is linked to this, I think this need for city council to rethink their role during a crisis and the openness I experienced a little bit to at least do that, to engage in a discussion.
Thank you, Jan, also for bringing in the experiences that are there in Rotterdam and the insights you have. Dalma, would you like to take the floor?
Yeah, thank you so much. My name is Dalma, and I wanted to add a little bit of to comment a bit on the issue of vaccine acceptance. There's currently misinformation on the side effects of the vaccine among communities, and especially migrant women, and to the extent that they're afraid of taking the vaccine. And the misinformation is based on the fact that based on the rumors going around among different communities that will prevent women, the vaccination will prevent women from having children. And I think this is quite a really issue that needs to be addressed. And I hope by creating awareness among communities on issues of preventive measures against the COVID will be very, very important. Thank you.
Thank you, Dalma. And I see Adi is even putting the microphone on. I think this is a very important message for her working at the GGD as well. Do you want to respond, Adi, or are you making notes?
I'm taking notes, sorry. I forgot to put out my microphone, but I'm taking notes and I see a lot of suggestions already appearing. So thank you.
Okay, thanks. Roy, would you like to contribute?
Yeah, quickly, which is first of all to say thanks for organizing and sharing all this. I appreciate actually that you keep it short, including the breakout groups, because then that means we can also do other things and we still get an overview. Anyway, my question or my thought, I think that's a better word, is what all these projects have to say about the idea of community, because I hear it a lot in I think how this session has been set up, also in the discussion. And of course, the term community has been problematized since it tends to homogenize populations, and it tends to write out power, which we find internal in any sort of group. So I wonder whether that might also be a useful sort of cross-cutting point to sort of rethink, possibly even reclaim, if you're interested in the term community, because alternative terms could have been used equally well, like neighborhoods or transnational population or populations of people. I used Jan using the term people, for example. So maybe that's something to think about. It just struck me, I guess. That's why I bring it up.
Thank you, Roy. I think this is also something to discuss further in smaller groups. I'm not sure whether I saw a hand of Jack. Is that right? And then he will be the last person to contribute, and then we really have to wrap up.
Just a little. I just want to add something. The pandemic crisis, of course, is not just only a health problem. It is also a social problem. And if we're going to address this problem, of course, we should not forget the most vulnerable sectors, particularly the undocumented, because they are the ones who gravely hit by this pandemic. Based on my experience, and of course, experience of my colleagues, they lost jobs. They have this fear. They weren't aware about what they're going to do. They have this psychological impact on them because they're also thinking about their families back home. So what they're going to do? They don't have money. So I think these projects or future projects, I think so the best way is, of course, to close this gap. There's a big gap, because the government does not have this, cope mechanism to address, to reach out these groups. So I think it's high time that they rethink, you know, to assess their policies when it comes to vulnerable groups. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. I think there's much more issues to discuss, and I think it's really a pity that we have to do this online and don't have the chance to have an interaction over a few drinks and have informal small conversations with each other. But that's the way it is, I think. I want to thank you all for participating in this webinar. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you had interesting new insights. Got a lot of positive energy and new ideas to carry on. I would like to mention once again the opportunity for a new round of projects funded through the Vital Cities, Vital Citizens initiative of the Erasmus University that we're part of. This funding opportunity is still open with a deadline of the 1st of July. I will share the announcement once again with my ISS colleagues, because all those proposals have to be submitted by ISS colleagues. So once again, thank you very much for being here and for your participation. And well, I wish you a very nice and sunny weekend. Thank you.
Thank you, Ike. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.